First of all, of course, we want to talk about what went wrong with the Starliner launch on the 20th of December, because the Starliner capsule won't be able to reach the ISS as planned. But don't worry, because Jim Bridenstine assures us that a lot of things also went right. So what are the consequences of this not-so-successful Starliner debut flight? And what will it mean for SpaceX's Crew Dragon? Talking of SpaceX, they are already preparing for the next Starlink satellite launches. The first one scheduled for the 30th of December and the other one not long afterwards.
And of course, we also want to take a look at the current status of Starship and the launch facilities in Boca Chica. Then China sets a new longevity record for a rover on the moon, and we also want to talk about what China has planned for 2020. And lastly, Space Force has finally been created. We now can finally enter the age of Starship Troopers. You know, get it? Starship Troopers? Starship, you know, Starship Troopers. So stay tuned for these highly interesting space developments. First of all, Merry Sol Invictus celebrations to you all! Because we always like to celebrate our good old Sol Invictus Day, which traditionally always has been on the 25th of December. Yeah, okay, and also Merry Christmas to those of you who like to follow this newer cult, this so-called Christianity. So after this brief history excursion, we want of course to return to our favorite topic, which is of course space. Because there's always a lot happening regarding this so-called space. You know, this gigantic, mind-bogglingly huge void that stretches on for no one knows how far actually, if it stretches on eternally forever, or if it is curved and therefore finite, of which no one knows why it's so freaking big, of which no one knows where it came from or why it even exists in the first place, of which no one knows why it has exactly three dimensions, or if there are more hidden dimensions, or what will happen to it in the extremely far future. Will there be a big crunch, a big freeze, or a big rip? You know, that weird thing, space.
So on the 20th of December, Boeing's Starliner CST-100 capsule had its first important uncrewed test flight. A United Launch Alliance Atlas V N-22 rocket with a dual-engine Centaur upper stage lifted off perfectly on the 20th at 6:36 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and everything went extremely well at first. But around 15 minutes after liftoff, when the Starliner capsule separated from the rocket, that's when things started going south, apparently. An early look at the telemetry suggests that Starliner's internal clock was somehow not set correctly. Starliner believed it was sooner or later than it actually was. Jim Bridenstine explained it pretty nicely. Starliner believed it was in an orbital insertion burn, or the burn was already complete, when in reality the burn hadn't even begun yet. Therefore, the spacecraft burned more fuel than anticipated to maintain precise control, using its dozen smaller thrusters, hence burning a lot more fuel much too early. So much fuel, in fact, that not enough fuel was left to propel the Starliner capsule to the ISS. The Starliner is at least in a stable orbit, just not the one that will let it rendezvous with the ISS. So now, of course, the question, what kind of implications will this incident have on the future crew test flights with Starliner, which would have been set to take place in 2020? So according to the NASA propaganda machine, it was not a big deal, because Jim Bridenstine assured us in the following press conference that a lot of things also went right, and that if astronauts would have been on board, they would have been totally safe. If the same incident had happened to SpaceX, we are pretty sure that NASA's words wouldn't have been so friendly. As of now, it's still too early to tell if this incident will delay Starliner's crewed flights to the ISS, which are planned for 2020. But one thing is certain, now SpaceX has even more head start towards sending astronauts to the ISS from American soil again. As things are developing right now, even with the brutal pro-Boeing lobbyism-sponsored bias of NASA, SpaceX's chances with reaching the ISS first in 2020 with their Crew Dragon capsule have greatly increased on the 20th of December. On this channel, we've always predicted that Crew Dragon would reach the ISS first with crewed flights in mid-2020, months before Starliner, and that estimate remains.
Talking of SpaceX, we all know, well, okay, not all, therefore we reiterated again like robots every time, how important Starlink actually is for our future efforts of space colonization. Now on the surface, Starlink just enables nice high-speed broadband internet for everyone on this planet, right? However, what's really extremely important with Starlink is the gigantic revenue that it will create for SpaceX, which is actually estimated to be around twice NASA's annual budget at some point in the 2020s. So the 2x NASA annual budget revenue of Starlink will turbo boost Starship and Super Heavy building, enabling to build a very large fleet of Starships and Super Heavies with destinations Moon and then of course Mars. And thus will enable humanity to become a spacefaring civilization. We should always keep that in mind when talking about Starlink. So the next Starlink launch is scheduled to take place on the 30th of December with the Starlink 2 mission, which will be the second launch of 60 finalized V1.0 Starlink satellites. Because you know, the first launch of 60 satellites back in May this year were only V0.9 test satellites. And then Starlink 3 is already set to follow in late January 2020. So it is quite evident that SpaceX wants to launch as many Starlink missions as possible in 2020. Gwynne Shotwell, the president of SpaceX, actually said at a conference in September this year that they want to launch as many as 24 Starlink missions in 2020. So a launch almost every 2 weeks. Okay, we think it probably will be a little less than 24 missions in 2020, but nonetheless probably still enough to start broadband coverage of North America. Now, as Elon has said, at least 400 Starlink satellites are needed for minor broadband coverage and 800 for moderate broadband coverage. So with this highly aggressive launch schedule which SpaceX intends for Starlink, we certainly will see moderate broadband coverage at some point in 2020, which we find absolutely amazing. But what is actually the current status of our favorite spaceship? Well, we know that SpaceX not long ago shifted its plans towards Boca Chica, with the Coco site being currently in sleep mode. In Boca Chica, work is fully underway, as we can see here, to build the Starship Mk3 prototype as fast as possible. Scrap metal from the previous prototype, so the Mk1, is used as building material for the Mk3, as we can see here. And construction for the Super Heavy launch pad is also underway.
Because now, of course, Super Heavy will also be built in Boca Chica. And both Starship and Super Heavy are also planned to be launched from Boca Chica now. Phew, we hope Elon will have convinced most people to leave Boca Chica by then. Because Super Heavy, with its at least 35 Raptor engines, will be quite a bit louder at launch than the Starship with its 6 Raptor engines. In any case, work on the future of space exploration is continuing near this small Texan village here, which we find quite funny. Not in a super cool high-tech facility near Cape Canaveral. Not in a super advanced military facility. No, outside in the open near a small Texan village. Who would have thought that 10 years ago? And that future will be amazing, with Starship and Super Heavy finally enabling us to build colonies on the Moon and later on Mars. Elon is restoring this timeline, as we often like to say on this channel, bringing us back the future that we were promised back in the 60s and 70s, but which never happened due to idiotic politicians. And what is China meanwhile doing? You know, we also have to talk about China, because we are an official Chinese Communist Party propaganda channel, as an extremely smart viewer of us immediately correctly recognized. So how did you find it out? We kept it such a good secret. So we all know that China is currently the only nation with a working rover on the Moon. The Yutu-2 rover, part of the Chang'e 4 mission, is still roaming around on the far side of the Moon. And this small Moon rover has now officially set a new record for the longest a Moon rover has ever been in continuous operation, beating the previous record of the Lunar Hot 1. The Soviet Lunar Hot 1 was operated back in 1970 for 10 and a half months on the Moon, making it the biggest success of the Soviet Moon program back then. It's said that they didn't manage to get the N1 flying and land cosmonauts on the Moon, because in this alternate timeline, the success of a Soviet manned moon landing would have led to continued high funding for NASA. And a giant continued moon race with moon bases in the mid-70s, and large cities on the moon in the 80s. Our timeline just sucks. I hate our timeline. Hot doesn't like this timeline. Hot wants another timeline. Best timeline. Hot doesn't like this timeline. Hot wants another timeline.
But She-Hulk, as we already said, our boy Elon is restoring the timeline again, so please calm down, okay?
Hulk, calm down. Calm down. What happened? So back on topic. Lunar Hot 1 set a record of 10.5 months. And now, the Chinese Yutu-2 has beaten that record with 11 months of continuous operation. And that even on the far side of the moon. Quite an amazing accomplishment.
And what else has China planned for 2020? Well, we all know that they want to launch their first Mars mission in that year, of which we have already talked, for example, in this video here. But they also plan to build and test their new Long March 8 rocket, which will actually be the first reusable rocket of a government agency. And with reusable, we mean a fully reusable first stage, so similar to Falcon 9. But still, the Chinese Space Agency will be the only government space agency that will have a reusable rocket of their own. Now, of course, we hope to see the European Space Agency and NASA follow soon, because reusability is, as we know, the future. So this Long March 8 will have a LEO payload capacity of up to 7.5 metric tons and will have a reusable first stage. Now, it is basically like a Falcon 9 with additional side boosters. In this animation, we can see that it will operate very similarly to a Falcon 9, even with a landing on sea. Now granted, they are strongly inspired by SpaceX, if not outright copying SpaceX, but hey, at least they are copying SpaceX, which is more than, for example, the European Space Agency, NASA or Roscosmos are doing. Because those space agencies still throw away the complete rocket after every use. Boom, throw it away, after every use. Now, the Long March 8 is not planned to launch very heavy payloads into orbit, but is more planned to launch smaller commercial satellites into orbit in a cheap way. But to be fair, we also have to say that the other Chinese rockets, for example the Long March 5, which will launch the 2020 Mars mission, and the Chang'e 5 lunar sample return mission, will not be reusable. As also won't be the Long March 9, China's future strongest rocket, which will be the one to someday in the 2030s bring taikonauts to the moon. So China won't certainly have a big lineup of reusable rockets anytime soon, but at least this is a small step into the right direction.
Now, will they be able to catch up to SpaceX? No, certainly not. But the more space agencies take even only baby steps towards reusability, the better. So it seems that China is getting quite powerful in space. And America certainly doesn't like that. Therefore now, the Space Force has been officially established as the 6th branch of the US Armed Forces. On the 20th of December, as the US President signed the National Defense Administration Act. The agreement creates a Chief of Space Operations for the US Space Force, who will directly report to the Secretary of the Air Force and become a member of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. And personnel from the Air Force can be transferred to the newly established Space Force by an Assistant Secretary of the Air Force for Space Acquisition and Integration, who will be the Senior Space Architect. Oh yes, and space is recognized as a war-fighting domain in this act. So then soon Starship Troopers or what? Now that movie seems, together with Idiocracy, like an extremely accurate prediction of the future. Also because of the name Starship Troopers. Get it? Starship Troopers. Because we think it's very likely that this newly established Space Force will buy a large batch of starships from SpaceX to use as their troop transporters. Then we would really have Starship Troopers.
Because please don't forget that Starship will, with the aid of Super Heavy, have the capability to land anywhere on Earth within 30 minutes. And we are pretty sure the military loves that kind of stuff. Oh yes, and troop transports to the future colonies on the Moon and Mars, you know, like colonial marines. Finally, we have the colonial marines or what? So let us make another prediction, because we just love doing predictions on this channel here. Even if they sometimes might turn out to be brutally wrong, but fortunately, probably no one will remember it by then. Now, we prophesized already quite a while ago that Starship will land on the Moon before NASA, and we still stick to that prediction. We also prophesized that we'll see Starship land on Mars by 2030 at the latest. And of course, we also prophesized that Elon would at some point, using Neuralink V5.0, merge with an AI and become benevolent immortal AI god. Yeah, okay, maybe that last one might not exactly happen like this. But we have to admit, it's kind of a fun thought and not completely impossible. Not completely. Because mind uploading will probably become a thing. Okay, but now back to our Space Force. So we want to make the prediction that this newly established Space Force will buy a very large batch of Starship and Super Heavies, or at least charter them from SpaceX, for using them as troop transporters. So that we finally get our well-deserved Starship troopers. Hopefully without bugs, okay? But probably the idiotic military propaganda that was also a key point of Starship troopers and which we found hilarious will be, let's be realistic, unavoidable. Because we all know the military just loves propaganda.
So do you think this failure of the Starliner capsule?
Partial success, NASA said. Partial success.
Okay, the partial success will delay the future crewed launches to the ISS with the Starliner. And do you think now SpaceX will be able to reach the ISS first with crewed flights?
I think yes. And then Space Force? I mean, do you agree with us that the Space Force will be highly interested in using Starship for military troop deployment to anywhere on Earth within 30 minutes?
The Chinese certainly won't like that.
Sorry, China. So be sure to let us know in the comments section.
And if you like our space news show, we would be very happy if you would subscribe and also turn on the bell, such that you don't miss any future episodes from us.
So, Christmas, so Merry Christmas to you all. For the ones that worship this new cult called Christianity, I prefer Sol Invictus.
Happy holidays, everyone. See you next time.